Okay, so I'm Rafael Jimenez, the Chief Technical Officer of ELIXIR. I'm here not just representing ELIXIR, but also Bioschemas. Bioschemas is a community trying to push forward schema.org for the life sciences. So this is the title of my talk. I think every time I read the title, I think it's a little bit pretentious. So I think the point of this talk was to tell you what is the role of schema.org in the life science, or at least to give you my opinion. So I think the idea or the reason why I came up with this title actually was a mail exchange with Toshi. You can see. So I hope that you don't mind, Toshi. Let me explain a little bit. So Leila Garcia, that is an attendee that came last year, she was proposing to use schema.org to annotate protein resources like UniProt or like INTAC or like PDB. And then Toshi was asking the question that normally people ask me, and that's the reason why I wanted to bring it here. So why to use schema.org? Why to bring annotations in schema.org if these resources already provide RDF? So I really believe in the coexistence of schema.org with the traditional way to provide RDF. So this comment came several times, and actually I feel like the ugly duckling among the RDF ducks. I wanted to explain a little bit more and to see what is the context of this approach. So I think for me, schema.org is not a replacement to APIs, it's not a replacement to RDF, it's basically a complement to things that already exist, and it's something that is more lightweight, and at the same time is compatible, because what is exposed in schema.org is, at the end, structured data that can be exposed in RDF-compatible format. So I think the target or the audience of schema.org is slightly different. So there are many certain synergies, but to me it's clear that something that we try to do with schema.org is to really expose the structured content to the search engines. Also, we try to classify the information in common schemas, something that probably is not done that well in RDF or in the traditional way to expose RDF, and to simplify the content federation. And also, at the same time, I think this is something that is best practices when you are exposing web content. So some people say that, well, what is the role of a schema.org? I think if you look at the wiki page for the semantic web, you will see that schema.org is the only example that is exposed at the very beginning. So schema.org is kind of rooted in a way that people can expose structured data. I think one of the successes of schema.org is the adoption. So you can see this study that was done by Dan Brickley and Guham in December last year. And they show that 30%, more than 30% of the websites are already compliant with schema.org and providing structured content in schema.org. So I think this is very impressive and something that is really contributing to the linked data and the semantic web. So I think, well, you don't know about the schema.org. It's something very simple. It's a structured data markup for web pages. So you have here a web page for recipes. And if you see the code, you will see that it says, OK, this is a recipe. And you have the normal HTML here in black. And what you will have is this markup information that will tell you, OK, so this HTML that says 144 kilocalories, so these are calories. And this is what we mean by calorie. So this is something that is supported not just by Google, but by most of the main search engines like Yahoo, Yandex, and Bing. And I think this has been a carrot for data providers. So why to expose RDF? What is the benefit for me, the data provider, to expose RDF? At least the people that expose information in a schema.org, they see the advantages. So they will be better exposed to the search engines, and they will be they potentially will have more visibility within the search engines. So at the end, most of the search engines, like Google, they see structured data, and they can visualize better structured data. So you can see, for instance, these entries, they have a picture, they have a rating, they have some basic information. We can create, they can create summaries. So something that is very useful, or people, I think, see this as very useful. So schema.org follow a model that is based on classes or types. So this is the properties for the type recipe, the example I was just exposing. So you have a property, you have the type, and you have a description, something that is very simple for me, at least. And yes, they have many types, in total 571 types, not counting the extensions that actually are apart from schema.org. So when I see this, I see that Google works with this information. So you have different content providers. They use schema.org as a way to standardize how the data is exposed. So Google can crawl that information, but actually you can do the same thing. So that you can go to the different web pages, the structured data is there, you can collect the structured data, and you can expose that information. So this is what we do, for instance, in ELIXIR. So we have a training portal. This is something very simple that we base on schema.org and bioschemas. So we do the automatic crawling of information using APIs, but also using schema.org. So you can build on top of schema.org and RDF as well. So what are the main differences between this approach, this new approach of schema.org, and the traditional way to work with RDF? So I think this is something that has been said several times. So I think this is the way I have in my mind that normally you expose RDF. So basically, you have your database, and you can expose that information through a Sparkle endpoint. You can expose the RDF files, or you can provide a web service or API to expose this information. So the main difference with HTML markup or schema.org is that that information, that markup, is within the structured data is within existing HTML pages. So for RDF, it's flexible, quite flexible. It's flexible knowledge representation, and you can have at the end your data mapped to the model that you have in your database, and this is very good. I think for a schema.org, you have a little bit more of restrictions. So it's a defined knowledge space where you have different types, and you will see that the different databases, they have different information, but they will express the information in the same with the same model. So I came up with a list of differences. Probably it will not be fair to compare schema.org with RDF, because I think schema.org as well is RDF. But if we could compare the traditional approach with schema.org, I think this is what I came up with. So the traditional approach is basically an additional interface. And an additional interface means a little bit of redundancy and probably more hassle to maintain the system. And this is something that has been mentioned in this conference. While schema.org is already within the HTML, it's the same content, so it's easy to maintain. Maybe you have the hassle of that you got mixed the structured data with the HTML content, but I think that's fine. So RDF is a flexible model, while the HTML markup is a defined common model, which requires quite a lot of agreements. The good thing about RDF, I think, is that all the data can be represented, while probably the schema.org is a limited model, and so not everything probably can be represented. So the flexible model also brings some disadvantages, and is that it needs a lot of messaging, a lot of data messaging, while the schema.org, because it's quite consistent, is easy to integrate. So the benefits of RDF is because you can have all the data, then you can potentially have more interpretations of the data, while for a schema.org, probably you can just have very simple interpretations of the data based on the model. So I think for RDF, I think it depends a lot on the context to be able to query the information, to be able to interpret the information, and this requires normally a domain expert, and a domain expert that knows not just about the technology, but also the biology. So I think it's very difficult to find that. I think for a schema.org, it's more approachable for users. I think it's something that is clear to understand. They have the types, and they have the properties per type. So I think it's more approachable for the user. So that's an advantage for schema.org. RDF is very adopted in the life sciences. So you can see by QRDF and OpenFacts and many other people adopting that, while schema.org at the moment, there are no biological types. If there are types, there are very few types. And I think the last is that I think for the adoption, and this is something that I mentioned before, so it's easier to adopt a schema.org, and RDF is something that takes a little bit more effort. So a little bit about bioschemas. Bioschemas is an initiative that tries to improve the definition of schema.org types. So basically, it's an extra layer on top that tries to add that definition and compliance. So basically, mean information, control vocabularies, cardinality, and also we try to look at those properties that are important for the life science, and we bring them into schema.org. So this is an example of the specification. So we have the data model that we inherited from a schema talk, and we have this extra information that comes from the bioschemas that is represented in one specification. So bioschemas works on generic types. So for instance, we can work with trained materials, with events, with databases. So this is something that can be used beyond the life sciences, but we try to provide the vocabulary to be able to define those entities, those types for the life science. And also we want to get more into defining biological types, but we know that this is more challenging. So we want to do this work with an existing group that is called the Health Life Science group. And this is something that is still undergoing. So conclusions for this. So I think, I hope that you are now more convinced that schema.org contributes to make a better web. It's a sustainable and also a lightweight approach for practical interoperability that we could use as well in the life sciences. Easy to adopt, and this is an advantage. And also, I think one of the carrots that is to make the content more available to the search engines, and I think this is very important. Yes, and this is another thing that is a very important point. This is linked data for people that do not care about the web semantic, the semantic web. And I think this is important. This is something more approachable for the users. So unfortunately, I think this effort is underrepresented in the life sciences and needs more support from you, from the community. So thank you very much. And I think before I finish, because I have still 4 minutes, I would like to talk about few proposals I wanted to bring here. So I really believe that we could do, well, at least I wanted to work with schema.org and bioschemas, and I was trying to bring few proposals that I think require very little effort and can have a lot of impact. So I think one interesting thing is that we have data repositories all over, and we have repositories or registries like biosharing, like the ELIXIR, biotools, identifies.org, Miriam, that are collecting the information about these repositories, but actually this collection is done manually. So we can do that more automatically if all those database resources could provide information in a schema.org. And anyway, I think it's a best practice that you have a website, you provide that information in a schema.org, and at the same time, the data resources will be more visible via Google. So what I was proposing is to work on defining the metadata that is important for our data repositories to expose to the world, to expose to these repositories, so these repositories can automatically collect that information. And I think there's important information there that should be exposed, like, for instance, information about the identifiers that are used by databases, like the versioning of the different releases of the different databases, like the APIs or where the RDF is located for one data resource. So I would like to work towards that goal. And in case that we finish this very quickly, I have more proposals that I can comment with you later on. So thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions, I will be very happy to answer them.